A warm welcome to all my students. Today in this subject of management principles, in this lecture I would be covering unit 1, which is introduction to management, and it includes nature of management, function of management, definitions, importance of management, elements of management, scope of management, management a science or an art, management functions and skills, development of management thought through the contributions of Taylor, Fayol, and also contributions of Hawthorne experiments. So these are all the topics that occur that will be covered in this lecture of unit 1. Well, the nature of management, talking about the nature of management, firstly, it is a universal process, as in it is involved in each and every aspect of all the human activities, whether it is business or it is for not for profit organizations or any other daily life activities also. Management is involved. You cannot think of doing anything without management being involved in it. It is one of the factor of production, a very important factor of production, like material, labor, and other capital and other things are factors of production. In a similar way, management is also a factor of production. Moreover, management is goal oriented. It is directed towards achieving some goal. It is supreme in thought and action. And management is a group activity, it is not an individual activity. Management can be performed in a group. Alright, management at the same time, it is a social process. It involves responsibility for economical and effective planning. It involves regulation of operation of the business. It is a dynamic process, not a static process, as in it keeps on changing its form. There are a lot of changes happening in the function of management, in the field of management. You need to be updated in this in these changes, and it helps in the fulfillment of the objectives of the enterprise, so that the enterprise is a successful business story. All right, coming to the definitions of management, various thinkers have given their own definitions, which are all very very important, very very effective. Like George and Jerry have given their own definition. They say that there are four fundamental functions of management, that is planning, organizing, actuating and controlling. Now Henry Fayol, he says that to manage is to forecast and plan, to organize, to command and to control. So according to Fayol, management includes forecasting and planning, organizing, to command and to control the operations of the establishment. Well, Luther Gulick has given a key word for us. It is POS DE CORB, which is P stands for planning, O for organizing, S for staffing, D for directing, C for coordination, O for organizing, R for reporting, and B for budgeting. So management, according to Luther Gulick, involves all these activities, and management is composed of all these activities. According to Coons and O'Donnell, function of management includes planning, organizing, staffing, directing and controlling. You could see some of the terms are repeating themselves, and some are not, some are new, like planning and organizing has been said by all the scientists, while few of the scientists have mentioned some other newer words like staffing, directing and controlling here. So different scientists have thought of different words that forms together to proper management. Now, what is let's talk about planning. Planning, what is planning? It is a future course of action. It is one of the basic function of management. It decides the future course of action, and in through planning we achieve predetermined goals. Planning bridges gap between what we are and what we want to be. It is an exercise in problem solving and decision making. Through planning we try to solve our problems and to make decisions, and it is a systematic way of thinking and means for accomplishment of it is a means to accomplish the predetermined goals. Now it is necessary to that the human and non-human resources available with the establishment are properly utilized. That's why planning is an intellectual property. It avoids confusion, uncertainties, risk and wastages that might have to be faced while operating your business. So thus planning is very beneficial for us, for the organization, for the business. Now let's read some more definitions of management. Like Henry Fayol put it in this way: to manage is to forecast, to plan, to organize, to command and to coordinate and to control. Fridman Malik defines it as transformation of resources into utility. Resources means land, labor, plant, machinery and raw materials, and into utility means something which is useful for the society. Now according to Peter Drucker, management is what modern world is all about. This statement means that all the development that you see around yourself in this world is because of continued efficient management of things that has taken place till now. So this is a very universal and general definition of management. Importance of management or significance of management. Management encourages initiative so that every person involved in the team wants to initiatively act and come forward and help in doing the things. And then it encourages innovation. Management, because of proper management, the staff or the employees or the team members become innovative. They try to find out ways to do the same thing in a newer way. It facilitates growth and expansion in the business. It improves the life of the workers. It improves the corporate image, that is the image that a company carries in the market, and it motivates employees. Also, management helps in the optimum use of resources. Optimum is neither maximum nor minimum. It is something which is the best use, best possible use of the resources available. It reduces waste, increases efficiency of all the factors of production. It improves relationships between different people involved in the business, like the employees and the employer and the management and the customers. It reduces absenteeism and labor turnover, because if everything is well managed, then people will be more inclined to work, to come to work every day, and they will not be very inclined to leave their jobs. So there will be lesser labor turnover, and it encourages teamwork. That is, if there is proper management in an organization, people are encouraged to work in a team and as a team. Well, what management finally involves, like all the authors or all the thinkers have said, it involves planning, organization, control, coordination, motivation, staffing and directing. Well, what is the scope of management? That is, where all management is applicable or used, utilized. So management is utilized everywhere. So functional areas could be marketing management, financial management, accounting. It is utilized in production, in inventories management, in material management, maintenance management, everywhere in every department of an organization, of a production organization or trading firm, management is involved. Moreover, management is an interdisciplinary subject. That is, it involves at the same time economics, psychology, it involves statistics, it involves research, it involves commerce. So it is multidisciplinary and interdisciplinary. It is universal, that is, it is applicable everywhere, each and every place. And it has become an agent of change. Modern management is an agent of change. It has brought out about a lot of change in the way we, work, in a way we live life, in a way we perform our business and other activities. So management acts as an agent of change. Alright, now let us talk about various thinkers who have put forward their theories regarding management. First of all, let us talk about Frederick Winslow Taylor. The theory that he propounded was called as scientific management concept. Frederick Winslow Taylor is also called as the father of management because he was one of the first thinkers to think about management. He was born in USA in 1856. Let's see what Taylor has contributed in the knowledge of management. According to Taylor, tasks should be scientifically set. Each and every person should be given a task, and that task that he is given should be scientifically set. Secondly, he said that the payment systems should be differential, that is, it should not be same and common for all. Payment should be different for different people, like it should be higher for more efficient and more faster workers as compared to a normal or a slow worker and less efficient worker. Taylor also said that the work of supervision should be reorganized and it should be divided. The work of planning and the work of doing should be separated, and there should be four, if there are eight people in a work, they should be divided into two. A group of four will be doing the planning part and another group of four will be doing the doing part of it. That was reorganization of supervision. Then he said that recruitment and training should be scientific and proper, and it should be very professional recruitment and training of the staff. Next he said that everything should be used economically, the resources, the raw material, the energy, and whatever inputs are there in the production, they should be very economically used. And lastly, he said that a mental revolution is the need of the hour. That is, the employees should think about their employers, and employers should think about their employees while dealing with each other, while doing the business, so that both of them are mutually benefited by each other's actions. So a mental revolution is needed. That is what Taylor said. Now talking about Henry Fayol's contribution to management. Henry Fayol, who propounded his theories, started his career as a junior engineer in a coal mine company in France, and there he became the general manager by 1880. What Henry Fayol proposed was a very contemporary management, which is very much relevant even today. One of the few things that he proposed was that the industrial activities should be divided into six groups, namely technical, commercial, financial, security, accounting, and managerial, and each person should be assigned for one particular activity only, one particular division only, and he should concentrate on that division, specialization. So thus industrial activities should be divided in this way. His second point was he gave qualities that should be present in an effective manager. He talked about physical fitness. Then he talked about mental ability or mental fitness. He talked about the moral character of a manager. He talked about educational qualification, technical know-how and technical knowledge about the manager, and finally he talked about the experience of a manager. That is, a manager should be aptly experienced, be very well educated and technically very sound in his knowledge, and he should be morally very sound, mentally very fit and physically very fit. He was of the opinion that managers should have all these qualities. About functions of management, he said that the functions of management can be of five components, that is planning, organizing, commanding, coordinating and controlling. Well, Henry Foyle also propounded 14 principles of management. So these 14 principles of management were, firstly, division of work, that is the work should be properly divided. Then he said about that authority and responsibility, there should be a parity, that is equalness between authority and responsibility. Whatever, if you are giving a person an authority, he should also be responsible for some task, whereas if you are giving some responsibility to a person, he should also be given some authority so that he can fulfill his responsibilities in a proper way. Thirdly, he talked about discipline in the organization. Discipline should be supreme. It should be of prime importance for the organization. Then he talked about unity of command. That is, every employee should get commands only from one of the bosses, one of the superiors, and not from more than one, or that is two or three bosses. That will reduce confusion. So that is called as unity of command. Next is unity of direction. That is, the whole organization should be directed in one way, in one direction. That is, from top level management till the bottom level management, the direction of the organization should be same. Next is subordination of individual interest to general interest. That is, every employee should subordinate or should keep general interest of the organization, give it a priority over the individual interest. Then the workers' remuneration should be fair. It should not be very complicated. It should be very fair to each and every person. Then degree of centralization that is implemented, it should be very well thought of. There should be not too much decentralization or too much of centralization. It should be very well balanced, centralization in an organization. Well, Henry Foyle further talked about a scalar chain, wherein the hierarchy of the organization should be so well organized that there are a number of personnel at each level, so that when an information is passed on, even if some person is not available, the information doesn't get stuck at that place. It goes on moving because of the presence of other employees or other management managers at the same level. So that's called a scalar chain. This helps in regular flow and uninterrupted flow of information. He talks about order. That is, each and every material and person should have its place, and every material or every person should remain in their proper places. All right, so that is order. He talked about equity, that is equality. There should be equality among employees, employer, management and all the staff of the organization. Then he talked about the stability in the tenure of a personnel. That is, employees should be given a more stable tenure. They should feel security about their tenure. That gives a lot of motivation for other employees to work, all the employees to work. Then he talked about initiative. That means every employee should should be very much encouraged to take part on themselves, to do some work. That is, there should be initiative among every personnel to take on jobs, take on responsibilities. Then finally it talks about esprit de corps, that is union strength, which means that together everybody can achieve more. So there should be a spirit of unity among the employees and a spirit of teamwork among the employees. Well, let's come to the next theory, that is the Hawthorne experiment. Elton Mayo was the chief researcher. He was also assisted by Roeth, Lisberger and Dixon. In 1927, Hawthorne, Western Electric Company in Hawthorne branch, conducted certain experiments, and these experiments lasted till 1932. Elton Mayo led this team. And they perform, basically they perform four major experiments. The first experiment was about illumination experiment. In this experiment, the illumination of the workplace was firstly increased. It was observed that as the illumination was being increased, the performance level and the productivity also increased. Well, after some time, after some days, the illumination was again slowly brought down back to the original level, but it was found that the productivity has not decreased accordingly, and it was concluded that illumination is not only the sole element of motivation, because as people started working together and give better performance, there was a bonding that was created between them, and even when the illumination was decreased, the good bonding between them encouraged them to give good productivity. So this was what they found out in the illumination experiment. Secondly, what they did was the relay assembly test room experiment. In the relay assembly test room experiment, six female workers were deputed to work with a researcher in a very friendly environment, and the researcher behaved in a very friendly and very friendly manner with them. And it was found that even after withdrawing all the facilities and all the perks given to them, even after withdrawing all of them, the productivity still went on increasing. And it was concluded that because of the belongingness to the group, because of the respect and recognition that they were getting in the group, led to the motivation, and hence that team worked very well even after withdrawing all the facilities. So that was a very fruitful experiment, very learning experience for them. Well, next was the mass interviewing program. In this program, each and every employee were called for an interview. An interview was taken for all the employees, and they were asked different questions. In the beginning, it was found that when they were asked questions, they did not respond properly, and that they were not giving much information. So finally, it was thought that asking questions was not the proper way, so they were just allowed to speak whatever they wanted to speak. They were allowed to speak up their mind. Then by doing this, it gave very good results, and the scientists came to know a lot of things from many employees that spoke up. So that information they compiled and came to many good conclusions. Well, we'll talk about those conclusions sometime later. The fourth experiment that they carried on was bank wiring test room experiment. Under this experiment, a group of 14 workers were allowed to work in a normal condition where they had a boss who used to command them. Earlier, they used to work in a very old fashioned way of working. So it was found that the 14 workers restricted their output and productivity. They set up their own goals and they did not try to exceed the targets. They also restricted others' performance also. If one of the employee would like to improve its performance, they would restrict his performance also. So it was concluded that in a very strict environment where there is someone to command those employees, motivation level is very low and productivity is knowingly restricted by some of the groups, that is social restrictions are put up, and productivity therefore doesn't go beyond a certain level. So these were the four experiments that was carried out. And what came out of this Hawthorne experiment is as follows. A business organization is basically a social system. It is not just a techno-economic system. This is what Hawthorne experiment contributed. The scientists found out that an organization is a social system. It is made up of people, and that's why it is a social system. It cannot just be taken as a techno and economic system. And then employees can be motivated by psychological and social wants, because his behavior is also influenced by feelings, emotions and attitudes. Thus only salary or money is not the only incentive, but there are other methods also to motivate employees. Well, group psychology plays an important role in any business organization. Therefore, we the management should rely more on informal group efforts rather than just formal group effort, rather than just formal way of communication. They should also involve into group communication, informal group communication, because group psychology plays its role in an organization. Then man is not a not just a machine, but it is a living machine, a very live machine, and it is very important machine. It is just not an inanimate machine, so it should not be treated like that one, because if an employee morale is very high, productivity will be high, and high morale results in higher output. That is what Hawthorne experiment told us about the employee morale and employee productivity. Management should learn to develop cooperative attitude towards his employees. Only command should not be the only way of getting the things done, getting the work done. Participation is an important instrument in human relations, and there should be participation among employees, and there should be good two-way communication between the management and the employees. Lastly, productivity is linked with employee satisfaction. Therefore, management must take great interest in employee satisfaction. That will lead to the increase in productivity. Alright, so these were the different contributions of the Hawthorne experiment, and a lot of new management concepts that we are seeing being employed everywhere in different organizations is what was proposed by the Hawthorne experiment, what was found by the Hawthorne experiment. So thus we can say that Hawthorne experiment and the thinking of Elton Mayo and his colleagues was very much about contemporary and modern management. Alright, so that was all about Hawthorne experiment and various thinkers of management who brought about a lot of good theories on management for us. Thank you very much. Have a good day.